streams flow as one river to wash away a brokenness. And here we see that God, you're moving. A time of jubilee is coming. When young and old return to Jesus.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Great Commission Community Church. It is so good to be here together with everyone. Our call to worship today comes from the Gospel of John, an eyewitness account of Jesus' life on earth. In John chapter 4, Jesus walks through Samaria and stops to sit at a well. There, he meets and converses with a woman whose life is transformed by her encounter with Jesus. Jesus' words to her can be an invitation and call to us to worship this morning. Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks of this water, that is, from the well, will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." Please pray with me. God, we come to you this morning declaring you are worthy to be praised and worthy of our worship and devotion. We who are hungry, thirsty, lost, hurting, and broken have found everlasting life and wholeness in you. We belong to you, and as your people, we worship you through Christ who died and rose for us. May our worship and the spirit and truth of Christ be pleasing, beautiful, and holy unto you. Amen. At this time, as you are able, please stand as we sing.
Lost. unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word.
Lord, I need more of you.
Lord, I want more of you.
Lord, I want more of you. Holy Spirit, rain down on me. Lord, I need more of you. A living breath of life, come and fill me. Jesus, we are thirsty for more of you. We are hungry, we are hungry, we are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus, we are thirsty for more.
Amen. The peace of Christ to you all. If you have been with us for some time, you know that we usually do sort of an extended prayer time together before we pass the peace. But just for the duration of this summer, we are doing something a little different. We are holding that time of extended prayer later in the service after the sermon. And this is just going to be something that we do a little bit differently as part of our response together to God's word. So again, the peace of Christ to you all. Please at this time say peace of Christ to you to someone around you. And also please receive that as a reflection of what is true in us already. And when you are done, we will watch the video we watched last week about how to get to the Synodic Theater in Crystal City, where we will be meeting the next two Sundays.
Records and we're making the dash. Oh, I'm buzzing the club.
This is how we do it.
Dancing to dancing like no.
Thank you again to the Park family for that demonstration. And also just as a note to Metro riders, Crystal City is the stop right after Pentagon City on the blue and yellow lines. So just take it to there. Two more notes about meeting at the Synodic Theater the next two Sundays. One, we will not be recording those two services to upload onto YouTube. So just please make a note of that. And two, if you have kids who are God's garden age, please just plan to arrive like 15 minutes early so that we can get all of the kids to God's garden, which will be next door to the theater. And then as always, on Tuesday evenings from 8 to 9 p.m. on Zoom, we host prayer meetings. And just an announcement that this week we will be praying about unity. On July 22nd, which is this upcoming Saturday, from noon to 3 p.m., the Race and Justice Ministry team will be hosting just sort of a discussion about parenting in an age of increasing harm and violence. So parents, soon-to-be parents, or really any individuals concerned about gun violence can join us again at noon on July 22nd. And Jared and Victoria Ng have generously opened their home in Annandale for this gathering. This is really just going to be a discussion of issues of gun violence as a church community, using content provided by the Asian American Christian Collaborative, scripture, and prayer. So, please, if you have any questions or you need a ride or anything of that nature, please reach out to Tony Hsiao. And just as a note, children are welcome, but please do know that child care will not be provided. And then on July 23rd, which is next Sunday, from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m., there will be a webinar on our denomination's positions on women in ministry and our own church's decision regarding that. And Pastor Steve will be talking more about this when he comes up to give us the sermon today. Also, another announcement from the Golf Connection Group. So there is a golf outing planned for August 25th. So if you are interested in joining, please just make sure to sign up online by July 23rd. And then finally, we as a church don't pass a physical offering basket to collect offering. We give online, but I would just like to pray for this week's offering, if you all would join me and bow our heads in prayer. Lord, you love us wholly, and you provide for our every need. And we know that we follow a God who sees the worth and dignity of every human being, and who gives us beauty for ashes. Thank you for your love and grace. We praise you for your goodness. And we just pray that as we give, our offerings would merely represent our love for you and our desire to do kingdom work. We pray that we would strive to love others as you love us. Lord, that we would just use our material resources to serve others and honor all that you have created. We love you, Lord. And in your Son's name, we pray all of this. Amen.
Okay, good morning. All right, let's try it again. Good morning. All right. It's good being here with you today. Pastor Carl is on his family vacation this week, so we want to be praying for him. Let's pray that God would renew him and his family. It'll be a restful week this week for his family. We are looking forward to going through our sermon series this summer. We'll be speaking from the Book of Psalms, and Book of Psalms is divided into five sections. We'll be focusing on the last book number 5, which is the last book from Psalm 107 to Psalm 50. And the theme that we gave for this book this season is giving thanks in all circumstances. And so we'll be talking about that, and we're looking forward to kind of going through different psalms with you this summer. Today, I'm going to speak from Psalm 133. And so if you have your Bibles with your devices, please turn with me to Psalm 133. I just want to let you know, it's been announced, I'm going to look at this psalm, and rather than kind of talk about giving thanks in all circumstances, we'll take a slight detour today. And I want to talk about this and apply to our church community in terms of a unity and the things that we've been thinking about, praying through with our denomination's decision on women in ministry and how that affects us. And we want to do this together, though. And so we want to look at this psalm, which is about unity. And I want to apply this to our context today, both collectively as a church community, but also personally, how it affects our own personal life. And so Psalm 133, it's a really short psalm, only 3 verses. So let me go ahead and read this for us. Psalm 133, a song of ascent of David. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Amen. So this psalm is really simple. The main point of this psalm is David, the author of the psalm, basically says how good and pleasant it is when brothers or family of God, brothers and sisters, dwell in unity. So this psalm is about unity. And I think for most of us, we can quickly say amen to this, right? Whether that's in our workplace or our family life, our kids are getting along for the parents here, your friendship, there's a sense of unity. It's good. It's pleasant. So we quickly can say amen to any kind of togetherness and unity. It's beautiful. But at the same time, most of us know that from human experience, unity is awfully hard to achieve and maintain, isn't it? I mean, there are divisions and splits all the time. I started going to church when I was about 10 years old. And I still can't remember during my middle school years, the church that my family attended, like out of nowhere, at least for me, to me anyway, it split. So one weekend I went to the youth group and I only saw half of my friends because the other half decided, or the family decided to split off from the church that they were part of. I still remember that. And so whether it's a church split or relational conflicts that you have with friends and family members, I mean, all of us can kind of know, we all know unity is beautiful and we want it so much, and yet it's so hard to achieve and maintain. So we'll look at this psalm, and I want to ask two questions, right? One question, number one is, why should we pursue unity? If unity is this hard, this elusive, why should we pursue unity? And then number two, the question that I want to ask is, how do we do it, right? How do we attain unity? And I think this psalm helps us with those two questions. So question number one, why should we pursue unity? So let me go ahead and read verse 1 and 2 one more time. It says, behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like a precious oil on the head running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. All right, when I was reading this psalm initially, Tracy Commons came to my mind. For those of you who know Tracy, he was with us for about 4 years. He left with his family about 2 years ago. He came to my mind because the verse kind of talked about this beard, and I cannot grow a beard or anything like that. But so I want to show you a picture of Tracy. I know this is not biblical, it's not exegetical, you know, but there you go. When I read this psalm, when I think about Aaron's beard, like Tracy gives me a picture of what Aaron's beard might have been like, right? It's Aaron was the first high priest. And he was anointed by God, and he was set apart from God to represent God's people to God. And the picture that we have here is David, the writer of the psalm, is comparing the unity of God's people to an oil that's being poured out on Aaron's head. And there's so much that is dripping down to his beard, and then it's dripping down onto his robe. And so what's David talking about here? And I think the process that David is talking about here is a picture that we get from the book of Exodus when God anoints Aaron. So let me read Exodus chapter 30, a few verses from there. It says, the Lord said to Moses, take the finest spices of liquid myrrh, 500 shekels, and of a sweet-smelling cinnamon, half as much, that is 250, and 250 of aromatic cane. And you shall make of these a sacred anointing oil blended as by the perfumer. It shall be a holy anointing oil. You shall anoint Aaron and his sons, and consecrate them that they may serve me as priests. And you shall say to the people of Israel, this shall be my holy anointing oil throughout your generations. So why should we pursue unity? Point number one, One, God's people's unity is like a beautiful aroma. So the picture that we have here is God says, pour out this oil. I used to think when in the Old Testament, when priests or kings were anointed, I thought the picture was maybe a drop or two. But the picture that we have here in Exodus is the oil is being poured out so much so that it's dripping down his beard and onto his robe. And so the first thing that we see here is this aromatic oil that's being poured out onto Aaron. And as it's being poured out, there is this beautiful, sweet-smelling aroma that fills that space. So I think for the picture that we get and the point that we want to think about is when God's people dwell in unity, it's like a beautiful aroma. When a pleasant aroma hits our sense of smell, what happens? Like we pause, right? And we ask questions like, where is this coming from? This is beautiful. We wonder. And I think the point is, what David is talking about here is when God's people dwell in unity, when brothers and sisters get along, there's togetherness, it's like a beautiful aroma. It might not explicitly explain all the nuances of the gospel message, but when Church of Jesus Christ, when brothers and sisters get along, there's togetherness, it causes people to question, like, how is it that these people, like, love one another so well? How is she sacrificing so much of her time to serve the church? Or how is he giving so much of his money to support God's kingdom? Like, they ask questions like that. And I think that's what David here is saying. When there's unity amongst God's people, it causes people to stop and ask questions like this. Like, how can this be when they seem like they're two different people from two different backgrounds, two different experiences, and yet they come and worship together? And that's why in the New Testament, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, the Apostle Paul says, Christians, the gospel is like aroma of Christ. For some, it's beautiful. It will lead them to life. And to other, it will lead them to death. Meaning, it's saying it's a presentation of the gospel. So number one, why should we pursue unity? Because in our unity, we are able to sort of produce a beautiful aroma of the gospel message. It will cause people to stop and ask questions. Number two, unity is needed for fruitful ministry. Aaron, in this passage, he's not just any person. He's the high priest, the very first high priest in Israel. And he was set apart to serve God. So the picture here is David is talking about when there's unity amongst God's people, it prepares God's people for service, right? It's a way of setting God's people apart so that they can be effective and fruitful in their ministry, in their service for God. And I think that's why when we read the New Testament, the Apostle Paul, when he writes to churches, he often always talks about unity, almost always. And he passionately opposes any kind of disunity in churches. And almost always, all the epistles that he wrote to different churches, he addresses this issue. So Book of Philippians, if you remember, the church in Philippi, there was division in the church out of envy and rivalry, the Apostle Paul says. And that's what he talks about in chapter 2, talks about you need to imitate the humility of Christ, he says. And in chapter 4, he actually names two people and basically says you need to get along. Book of Galatians, there was division because of the ways that Jews still practice circumcision. The division was around Old Testament laws. The church in Corinth, there was division out of spiritual pride. Almost every church that Paul wrote to, he addressed the issue of division. And here's the reason why. Because for Paul, disunity got in the way of an effective witness of the gospel. See, Paul was a missionary, right? He went to cities to plant churches. And when he saw the dysfunction, the disunity of churches, he passionately opposed it. He rebuked the churches because in his mind, he's saying, there's nothing that should get in the way of the gospel advancement, a gospel message. And disunity does that. And so, number two, why should we pursue unity? Well, it's because it prevents us from, disunity prevents us from effectively proclaiming, displaying the gospel message. Unity prepares us for effective, fruitful service. Philippians chapter 1, verse 27, Paul says this, right? Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel. Unity helps us to be part of God's work. This unity prevents us from doing this. Last sort of comparison here that David makes in verse 3, he says, unity of God's people, it's like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. So the comparison is, David is talking about a dew that falls on Mount Hermon. Mount Hermon was the highest point in Israel. It was in the northern part of the nation, and because of its elevation, there was always dew, snow, and rain, and so there was always lush greenery in the peak of Mount Hermon. And so as people saw the mountain, they recognized that it was full of life. And so David here is talking about how when there's unity, there's refreshment, or there's life, it flourishes, right? And I think most of us have kind of experienced that, whether that's, again, in your family life or maybe your friendship, your workplace. When there's unity, it just, it's pleasant. There's life. There's flourishment. Versus where there's disunity, dysfunction, when there's conflict that's not resolved in a right way, well, it drains life. And so David here says, when there's unity, it provides life. People flourish. So why should we pursue unity? For those three reasons. So here's the second question, probably maybe more important question. How do we maintain or attain unity? How do we do this? I think most of us will, like, we know intuitively that unity is good, it's pleasant, it's good for us, and yet it's hard to achieve. So how do we do it? So I'm going to share three things from this psalm. Number one, well, how do we attain unity? We attain unity as all of us are shaped by Christ-centered worship. So if you were here last Sunday, Pastor Carl talked about book number 5 in the book of Psalms, and it's subdivided into sections, right? So the first section seems like, and it's not like really distinct, but the first section seems like it's from Psalm 107 through Psalm 118. First section talks about the steadfast love of the Lord, and then there's a break there. Psalm 119 is about God's word. And then from Psalm 120 through Psalm 134 is called the Psalms of Ascents. And it's called Psalms of Ascents because they were psalms that people sang on their way up to Jerusalem to worship God. So if you read the Old Testament, there are a lot of these feasts. There are 7 feasts that the Israelites celebrated. And they have different names, so it's kind of hard to kind of put all those things together. But there are 7 feasts. And then amongst those 7 celebrations, God's people were called to go up to Jerusalem 3 times a year to worship God together. So the first one happened during the Feast of Passover and Feast of Unleavened Bread. They're together. And so they're called to come up to Jerusalem to worship God. So if you could imagine the whole nation. So for us, it might be like Thanksgiving, right, where you know that Thanksgiving season, you want to spend time with your family. So whether you're from California to Toronto to Florida, let's say your home is in Washington, D.C., well, you're kind of planning your trip, and you're gathering with your family to celebrate and be thankful. It was kind of like that. Three times a year in the Old Testament, God said, no matter where you are, three times a year, I want you to come up to Jerusalem to worship me together. And during this time, you're supposed to bring a sacrifice, whatever you can afford. You bring your sacrifice, you make sacrifices, you worship God. And during those journeys up to Jerusalem, they would sing Psalm 120 through 134. So this is part of their journeying up to Jerusalem. They're singing these psalms, and Psalm 133 is one of them. All of the feasts, or almost all the feasts and the journeys up to Jerusalem, it was centered around God's act of deliverance of His people out of Egypt. Right, so the Feast of Passover. As they remember, what they were called to remember was how God passed over them as they placed the blood of a lamb on their doorpost so that the angel of death would pass over them. So as they celebrated these feasts, and as they went up to Jerusalem to worship God in this way, they were called to remember God's mighty act of rescue, salvation, deliverance, redemption for their people. It happened again and again and again. So, for instance, Feast of Unleavened Bread. Well, it reminded them how quickly they left Egypt without looking back, so that the dough didn't have time to rise. So they were remembering how God delivered them. It happened over and over and over again. The Feast of Booth. It was for them to remember how they lived in tents for 40 years, and yet their clothing and their shoes did not wear out. Again and again, seven times a year, seven feasts, three journeys up to Jerusalem, they were called to remember God's faithfulness. You know why God did that? It was because it anchored God's people. It shaped them. And in their anchoring, in their shaping, it united them. They worshiped the same God. They remembered together God's act of deliverance for them. It was a powerful time, right? They're singing and worshiping. They're remembering God's past faithfulness. They did this again and again and again until it shaped them. Friends, that's what we are after when we gather to worship on Sundays. I think Pastor Carl, not only does he oversee Arlington, but he's our worship pastor, meaning he puts together liturgy for us on Sundays. And we talk about this all the time. When we gather on Sundays, we want to be shaped by Christ. We want to tell His story. We want to experience God's presence. Why? So that we are shaped by Him. So we're anchored by something that's more than what the world says to us. We're shaped by who we are in Christ. We remember that every Sunday. Not only are we doing this weekly, but yearly, our church calendar is anchored around three seasons. For those of you who've been with us, you know this, right? The first season is season of Advent. We remember how Jesus came the first time as an infant. But we also long for His second coming. And then we celebrate the season of Lent. During that time, we remember Jesus' sacrifice, how He lived, how He served, and eventually how He died on the cross. And then we celebrate season of Easter. We remember Jesus' life, His resurrection, and what that means to us. Our whole church calendar is shaped by who Jesus is and what He accomplished. And essentially, that's what the God's people in Old Testament were doing. They were remembering how God delivered them. So for us, we remember how God delivered us from our Egypt. And we celebrate the blood of the Lamb. And those things shape us. And we want to do those things well. We are shaped by them, and we are also united by the same truth. We're celebrating, we're remembering Jesus. His virgin birth, His sinless life, His atoning death, His bodily resurrection. These doctrines unite us. Now, I want to say that because we are talking about women in ministry and polity, church polity, how we organize ourselves as a church. The denomination has recommended and decided certain things for us. And so we are in a season of thinking through these things and praying through these things. But I want to say what ought to shape us mostly, what ought to anchor us deeply is Christ. Nothing else. Christ, He is our anchor. He shapes us. And we talk about that every Sunday. Our yearly rhythm is about Jesus. That's what unites us. And so how do we attain unity as God's people? Well, when we worship together regularly. And that's why, I know I'm speaking to the choir here, but that's why coming to church on Sundays is important. Don't let other people say otherwise, because it shapes us. When we gather together as God's people, worship, listen to God's word being preached, as we worship and take communion, as we sing, pray, these things, if we do it regularly, shape us. I have 3 kids now. Well, I shouldn't say kids. They are now in college. And they are with, unfortunately, when my kids grew up here at GCCC, we didn't have a youth group. And so my kids actually, when I was young, we did a church plant up in Philly. When you start a church, you start with 20, 30 people, and they actually never had like a youth group, like peers that they could relate with. And so, for a long time, our prayer was that even though they might not have peers at church, that God would shape them through just coming to church consistently and being with God's people together. My daughter just graduated, and she said she had a little kind of graduation party at church at Tyson's, just with, some people. And she shared. She said, even though we didn't have a youth group, what shaped me is you. Some parents were here, some younger kids. You shaped me as you taught me, as I sat there. You shaped me. And so, friends, worshiping together on Sundays is important because it not only shapes us individually, but we're shaping one another. It shapes us. We're being shaped together communally. So that's my second point. 2, we attain unity by having family conversations. These feasts, this Psalm 133 that was sung as people went up to Jerusalem, it wasn't done in isolation. It was a communal thing. It was a family affair. Let me read from Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 10. So this is a description of one of those feasts, right? God says, then you shall keep the feast of weeks to the Lord, your God, with the tribute of a free will offering from your hand, which you shall give as the Lord your God blesses you. And you shall rejoice before the Lord your God, you and your son and your daughter, your male servant and your female servant, the Levite who is within your towns, the sojourners, the fatherless, and the widow who are among you, at the place that the Lord your God will choose to make his name dwell there. You shall remember that you are a slave in Egypt, and you shall be careful to observe these statutes. These feasts, these journey up to Jerusalem to worship, they were communal events. You didn't do it alone. You had brothers and sisters, sons and daughters, servants, Levites, widows, sojourners. You got together to talk about these things. You sang together. And that was important because you could imagine, right, the father and mother getting their kids together and talking about, here's why this week we're going to sleep in tents. Why, mom, dad, why are we sleeping in tents? Well, it's a way for them to talk about how their people, God's people, wandered in the desert for 40 years. They lived in tents, and yet God provided for them every day for 40 years. Again, they might be asking, God, mom and dad, why are we doing this? Why are we taking a lamb to sacrifice in Jerusalem at the temple? Well, they talk about the Passover. Why are we eating unleavened bread this week? Well, they talk about how they quickly, permanently left Egypt and pursued, followed God. It's a way for them to talk about these things. And that's how we are shaped and we become united. When we talk, we share our stories. I think Pastor Carl talked about that last Sunday, Psalm 107, right? There are these stories that people talked about and they declare the steadfast of the Lord never ceases, but it endures forever. As you talk about these, as you share your stories, you become united. And our goal, our hope is that during our in our small groups, like those things are happening. In our small groups, you're talking about your story and how God met you and how God is leading you. You're talking about these things, and it's through these stories we become intertwined. Now, at times, these stories that we share and the conversations that we have, they can become unpleasant, right? There could be hard conversations. But most of us, we all know this. We all know that if we want to go deeper, that we need to share stories that might not be comfortable. And most of us, I think, most of us don't like to talk about uncomfortable things, right? It's much easier to talk about pleasant things. But unless we talk about uncomfortable things, like our unity, our friendship, our relationships will only stay at a superficial level. If you want to go deeper, like we have to talk about conflict. We need to know how to resolve conflicts. Any married couples here? If you, isn't that right? Like, if you want to go deeper in your marriage, you need to know how to resolve conflicts. Yes? I see Michelle nodding her head. All right, I'll take that. You know, that's how it is. And so, that's what we're going to do. Families have difficult conversations. Parents have difficult conversations with their kids. It happens. You need to have these conversations. I remember when we had our partnership with our Spain team. We had it for 10 years, and our job was to go to Spain, establish a retreat center. We would provide meals for them, did VBS for them. We fellowshiped with them, prayed with them, worshiped with them, did devotions with them. So our whole goal was to provide a time where they could be refreshed. I still remember our first one there. We get there, we're running the retreat, And one afternoon, the missionary team went into a meeting. And that meeting probably lasted about 5 hours or so. And we didn't know this at the time, but they had this long, intense meeting. They came out, and at the end of the retreat, they told us, you know, we were having some intense conflicts in our team. And without this space, like the space that you guys provided for us, I mean, this is what they told us. They said, we're not sure if we would have survived because there was tension and conflict, and they just didn't have time to, like, process it together. So they came out of that conversation, that retreat, just really being thankful to us and to God for allowing them to have these hard conversations, yet come out of it sort of more unified. And so not just our church, but churches, we have these conversations that are like hard or are messy. And I've been here now 13 years, and I can still remember many conversations that were hard. Some of them did not turn out well, others did, but there were hard conversations and we need to have them. So we're going to talk about the decisions that our denomination made. And for some, this is not a big deal. Others, this is really important. And so no matter where you are, you're invited to be part of this conversation. It's the webinar. So the three categories that we're going to talk about, the decisions that our denomination made is, one, our denomination has retained male eldership. So at our church, at our denomination, elders are male. Number two, our denomination has decided to consecrate and ordain both men and women, official workers now. And then number three, our denominations stated that title pastor can be given to both men and women if the local church's understanding of Scripture allows them. And so we're going to talk about these three things. And I want to invite you to that. Come. And again, some of you, this is like, it's not a big deal for you. Others of you, it's a significant deal. And so we want to talk about it. I'm kind of envisioning maybe an hour and a half. The first half will be like me presenting these three things. And I've been preparing, and so hopefully it will be good and helpful. And I think it will be. I think it will be helpful. And then second half will be like Q&A. So you're all invited to the conversation. And again, the goal being we want to be more unified, united, and wanting that outcome, conversation is needed. And that's, again, this is true of churches and your family life, your friendships, your work. I mean, you need to have these conversations, and we want to have them well. And we want to do it well. So, come on out. All of you are welcome to that. Lastly, and then we'll close. Number three, we attain unity as God's blessing flows down. So when you read this psalm, I'm going to read it one more time, and there's a word or phrase that's repeated three times. And I think it's there for a reason. It only has three verses, but it's the word that's translated to like running down, like falling down. Okay, so let me read the psalm one more time, kind of stressing that word. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard. On the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon running down, which falls on the mountain of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. So the picture is God's blessing, the oil is running down, flowing down. And I think this is what we're supposed to get. Unity at the end of the day has to be a divine spiritual work. A lot of times we think about unity. How do we get unified, you know, as a company or, our marriage or friendship? And we talk about, like, personality, our background, experience. We talk about a lot of these things, and these things are helpful. But at the end, I think biblically, scripturally, especially God's church, it has to be a blessing that's fall down upon God's people. And here's the reason why. When you look at scripture, division happens from the very beginning. Genesis 3, sin happens, sin falls, and then immediately there's division, right? Adam and Eve, division. Like they're blaming one another. They're ashamed. They're covering each other from one another. And then right after chapter 4, they have sons, Cain and Abel. There's division, conflict. They're not able to resolve it. There's murder. And then even when God starts over with Abraham, Abraham has a son, Isaac. Isaac has two sons, Jacob and Esau. We talked about this past fall. There's division, conflict, deception. And then Jacob has 12 sons. Amongst 12 sons, 11 of the sons sell one of their own brothers as a slave. Division, tension, brokenness, pain. That's how God's people like existed from the very beginning. And then eventually those 12 sons become 12 tribes. And then there's division again. It happens again and again and again until there's big division between northern kingdom and southern kingdom. Northern kingdom, kingdom of Israel. Southern kingdom, kingdom of Judah. It happens again and again and again. And that's why I think ultimately, like, we need God's spirit to be poured out upon our lives and our hearts to change us. That our hearts become less self-centered, selfish, and become more kind and loving towards others. That's how it ultimately happens. And so, just applying to our church context, and this could be applied to any of your relationships, I want us to pray. I want us to pray for our church. If you care for a Great Commission Community Church, I know some of you are new here, and so you could love this church too. But if you've been here for a while, and you consider this your church, I want to encourage us to pray for this church, for this local body. So this Tuesday, we're going to pray for unity. Because I think at the end, the reason why churches divide, split, It's not because you know one group didn't like the color of the carpet, you know, and the other they were fighting over, like, you know, things like that. Ultimately, it's a heart issue, right? People have hard time acknowledging that they're not right, they're wrong. Like, it's hard to humble yourself before others. And that's why in Philippians chapter 2, as the church in Philippi, there's division. Paul writes about Christ and imitating his humility. Jesus, who considered, although he was God, he did not consider equality with God, but he emptied himself, became a servant, even to a point of death, death on a cross. And Paul says, if you have any likeness of mindset like me, imitate, be like Christ. Imitate Jesus' humility. And so we're going to be praying for that this coming Tuesday. I want to encourage you to come out. Let's pray. Pray that God's Spirit would fall down upon our church. And we could be praying for other things too, but that God's presence would fall down upon our church, because we know that if we are followers of Jesus, the Spirit that dwells in you dwells in me. And that's ultimately how we are connected. We really are brothers and sisters in Christ. I still remember when I was preparing to do a sermon series on sex and marriage, one of the things that I found out or kind of thought about was our marriage relationship between husband and wife, it's for this life, right? This life. But our relationship with brothers and sisters in Christ, that will last forever. This is a big deal. This is big before God's heart. And so let's pray that God's Spirit would fall down upon our church and really unite us, even as we have conversations that are not easy. I want to just one last thing, and then we'll pray. This psalm, Unity, it was written by David. So think about David's life. For those of you who know his story in 2 Samuel, David had both highs and lows, right? And the high point, I think, when I think about his life, most of us would think about David and Goliath. Maybe that was a high point. But the high point that I think is when he actually became the king. And in 2 Samuel chapter 5, he becomes the king of Israel and Judah. Like, the whole nation gathers around him. And sometimes I think maybe it's at that point he writes this psalm, perhaps. Because for the first time in a long time, like, David becomes the king and everyone's around him. There's a celebration. God's blessings falls down upon him. And maybe David thought about how God initially, his presence fell down in the tabernacle as they anointed Aaron. But that was a high point. There was this unity. That was beautiful. Good. God's blessings fell down. But he also had some low points. Probably highlighted by his own son Absalom wanting to destroy him. That's a low point, this unity. And his life, his relational world, his family life was fractured into many pieces. And so maybe David sang this psalm as a prayer. Maybe it wasn't a declaration, but it was maybe a longing and a prayer. So I think I want to end with this. Most of us, if not all of us, we have relational conflicts and divisions and tensions that we are going through right now. All of us, probably. The relationship that we hope will be fulfilling, it's not fulfilling. It's something lacking. There's tension. Maybe there's resentment. Maybe there's pain as you think about people around you and the relationships that you have with other people. Well, this psalm can be your prayer. We could pray, God, I know that unity, loving one another, is beautiful and good and pleasant. And I know that this ultimately comes from you. God, won't you have mercy and pour out your presence and your Spirit upon this relationship so that there will be reconciliation and forgiveness and healing. That could be a prayer. So I'm going to lead us into a time of prayer. And we'll pray corporately together. And then I'm going to give us some time to just pray on our own. The corporate prayer, I'll say the prayer. And if you could, and I'll end each portion by saying, Lord, we are yours. If you can respond back by saying, Lord, make us one. Okay, so let's practice that. Lord, we are yours. All right, let's pray together. Yeah, a few things. We thank you for your word, which reveals your heart for us and shows us the way we ought to live with you. And so even as we speak now in response to what we've heard, we're still listening with our hearts open to you. The Holy Spirit, search us and know us as we pray. Lord, we are yours. Your word says that we are brothers and sisters in Christ. We are part of God's family. We confess that at times we forget that that's who we are. We've communicated through our words and actions that we have no need of one another. We repent of our self-sufficiency, pride, and selfishness. And though you call us to love and serve one another, we confess we have not always done so. That's true in our local community here at Arlington, but also true within your global church. Forgive us of our sins and restore us to yourself and to one another. Lord, we are yours. We thank you for the beautiful gifts that you've given to us, a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. We celebrate each person among us that makes up the body of Christ and for the many ways you've given us to dwell together in unity. Thank you for the relationships we've formed in this community. Thank you for giving us opportunity to extend grace, kindness, and hospitality to one another and to give our talents and treasures in service of your gospel and your kingdom. Thank you for the diversity of this church family and for the beauty that's in it. Lord, we are yours. And finally, thank you, Jesus, for your prayer for us that we might be perfectly one, just as you are in the Father and the Father is in you. This was your prayer that the world might believe that God had sent Jesus to them and loved them, just as Father loves the Son. We humble and submit ourselves to one another and to you. For we know that our love and unity can become a beautiful aroma to the world around us. Lord, we are yours. Friends, I'm going to give us just a moment to pray on your own. Think about people in your life, relationships that you have. Maybe it's with your parents or siblings, friends. My guess is that there are tensions and disappointments that we're going through now or we've gone through. Maybe our relationships are broken and we need God's restoration. We need God's reconciliation. We need God's presence in these areas of our lives. And so let's do that, shall we? Just take a moment and lift up different people, people who might be in pain, and maybe it's just hard for them to even try to love and try to serve because they're far from God. Maybe you could just pray that God would draw them to himself and begin to soften their hearts so that they can be filled with God's love for them. Give us a moment to do that, and then we'll take communion together afterwards. Amen. I'm going to present communion to you, and let's remember that this is how we are shaped. We're shaped by the cross, we're shaped by Christ, we're shaped by his life and his death and his resurrection for us. And so as we come to the table, if you are a follower of Jesus, you can take the cup, and on the top has a wafer that reminds us that Jesus' body was broken, and then the cup has juice that reminds us that Jesus' blood was shed for us. the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." The same way he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Drink from it for the forgiveness of your sins." So friends, whenever you're ready, we have two stations, one up here and one in the back. Yeah, let's reflectively take and eat and drink the body and the blood of Jesus.
worship, continue worshiping. Yeah, I just want to encourage you to not feel like you have to sing the words, but take time to pray. Just reflecting on what unity means to you. Even if you don't know the person on your left or your right, you know, just pray over them. Pray that they would experience unity and family and oneness with God and His community. Yeah, make this worship yours.
Let the righteousness of God be your holy flame. is over, we will see you face to face, friend forever.
Before I pray for us, just a few, I guess, comments, announcements before we close. One, Synetic Theater, we're meeting there next Sunday. And so if you've never been there, I want to just encourage you to maybe leave, give yourself an extra 10 minutes. I was there and I did what the video told me not to do, and I got lost. And so, 10 minutes just so that you can find your way. Second, if you're visiting us for the first time, I met a few guys just before the service, visitors for the first time. We're so glad you're here with us. Please linger and connect with someone. I would love to meet you personally, so please come and say hi. And then lastly, this Tuesday, we're going to pray for church unity. And so we'd love to see some of you there. It's an hour. It's over Zoom, so it's both convenient, but it's not as maybe personal. But we'll gather together to pray. So I want to invite you to join us. Let me pray for us as we close. Dear God, we just acknowledge how frail we are. It's so hard for us to live out of humility or display humility. It's so hard for us to love, genuinely love and serve others. And yet, this is what you called your church to be and to do. And so with our hands open, we ask for your presence and your spirit to fall upon us and our church body collectively so that we might be unified and really experience this goodness and the beauty that you have for us. I also pray for those of us who are in the midst of relational conflicts and tension and even pain, brokenness. You know how hard that could be. So I pray for healing. Pray for forgiveness. Pray for restoration, reconciliation in our hearts. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the enduring love of the Father and the intimate fellowship of the Holy Spirit be upon you both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Thanks so much for coming today. Have a great week. We will see you next Sunday at Synodic Theater. Thanks.